Hi, today I'm prepping panels for abstract, and the first thing I did was decide on my color palette, and so I chose that. And then the second thing that I do before I get started is paint all the panels with some wood sealer and gesso, and then I tape the edges up so they look nice and neat and tidy. And I don't get a whole bunch of fingerprints on them, and I even kind of go wrap around just a little bit. Sometimes I still get fingerprints on them, but I try to clean them up before they go to the gallery because I have to wire them anyway and label them and all that. So anyway, back to the story. So today I'm prepping these, and what prepping involves before I even begin any kind of design is three layers of oil and cold wax medium. And so what that looks like is about a 50% mixture of oil paint and cold wax medium, which is resin, beeswax, and some other things in it that make it set up or operate the way that it does. And there's this beautiful combination that happens when you blend the two. And the whole beauty of doing oil and cold wax is to get the transparent layers, to be able to layer, to be able to scratch through and bring out some of the history. And the thing that I enjoy is the mark making and doing all of that. And none of that would look that fabulous if I just put a design on the canvas without doing these three layers. So that's why I do the three layers. And if you want to learn about oil and cold wax, there's a book out there, the Oil and Cold Wax Medium, the Bible of oil and cold wax medium. And I'll be teaching some of those, some classes in that coming up here as soon as my studio is done. So stay tuned for that. Anyway, I have accomplished two layers on this one, and this one is done. It's got its three layers on. The first layer was ultramarine blue. Second layer is golden ochre. Third layer is going to be quinacridone red, because my color combination when in my piece, my plan is to use some transparent orange, which is mixed with a little white, and a little bit of quinacridone red mixed with that transparent orange and white, and letting some of the darker quinacridone peep through. And then the ultramarine blue and the transparent orange make these fabulous greens. And I can also get some pretty terrific colors of gray and darker greens. And this is my sample sheet that I did. I had sort of this, you know, little mini brainstorm, and I just grabbed a quick piece of paper and just threw that on here just to see if my colors, how they would look, and if I would get what I was going for, because I really want a piece that has a lot of this golden in it with this bluish background or lighter color. And my painting won't look anything like this, which is perfectly okay. I have no idea where it will go. I always just sort of respond to whatever I've put down. So let me get to it and put the red, quinacridone red on here, and you can sort of see how it's done. So let me switch that. And I've got it mixed up over here, and I'm going to use this tool, which is it's very messed up, as you can see. This is a Mesermeister. It's a bowl scraper. It's a silicone bowl scraper. It's kind of soft on the edges and really hard on the inside. It's like a little metal plate in it. And it works great. So this is what I use. So I'm loading it up. As you can see, I've got it loaded up pretty good. And I'm just going to lay it down and go across here to get a nice layer on it. And you could put it on a lot thicker, Sometimes I put it on really, really thick, but on these, I'm not doing it as thick. Just you know, changing things up a little bit. That blue is sat on there for a few hours, the first layer. So that's going to make a nice base layer for scratch through. Okay, I am mixing colors to see what palette, so that, I mean, this will just make so many colors. I obviously won't use all the colors on my next piece, but I want to see what my combinations are so that I can choose the colors that I feel would look really nice on this upcoming piece that I'm working on, or two pieces that I'm working on. So what I have here is I have ultramarine blue, quinacridone red, this is transparent orange, black, and white. And I am using, on my painting, I'll be using oil, these are oil paints, and cold wax mixture. And I've already pre-mixed these with about 50-50 of the cold wax medium. And then I've got my little sheet of paper here, and I will start mixing. So I will, I'll use this area for mixing, and then try to keep this somewhat tidy for the camera here. First thing that I will do is I'll pick a little bit of warm color, and a little bit of a cool color, and mix those together. And I know that I'm going to get this this terrific purple here. Isn't that beautiful? That's a pretty color. So let me move that right there, because that is a derivative of those two. I'm going to run out of room, I know. But that's the way this goes. Now, if I take that color and I mix it with a little black and a little white, I'll be able to get varying shades of that. So let me take a little bit of that, mix it with a little bit of black, mix it with a little less black. Yeah. And then I'll get this beautiful kind of a dark plummy color. And I could just do just a tiny bit of black with that, or I could do a lot of black with that. And the more, when I add the black to it, it desaturates it. Okay, so I've got a little bit of that left, so I'm gonna leave that right there. And then I will mix it with just a little bit of white. This is that purple color, and I can mix it with a little bit of white, and I can get varying shades of lavender desaturated. So that's that. And then if I mix that with the black and white, add a little more black to that, what I'm going to get is a beautiful purpley gray. Look at that. Isn't that pretty? Okay, so let me clean this up and move on to the next one. So that was the ultramarine and the quinacridone red. So now what I will do is I will mix the ultramarine with the transparent orange. There's the ultramarine. Go up here and grab some transparent orange, a little more so that I have about the same. And I'm going to get this very dark. This is a beautiful green. Oh my gosh, look at that. Wow, look at that beautiful green right there. Isn't that pretty? Now, let's see, let's mix a little bit of that beautiful green. Am I still on the camera here? I know I'm working my way down, so I'm kind of worried. And then I get this this lovely derivative with the white. And let's just put that aside. And then come up here and get some black.
and mix some of the black with it to desaturate it again. I desaturated it there with the white, and this is with the black, and so it is pretty nice. Now I'll mix the two of those together. And I get this lovely gray. I'm going to add a little more black to that to really gray it down. Maybe a little more white. And you end up with this lovely green gray. Okay, so that's those guys. So next, let me wipe my palette knife off here a little bit. And let me pop this up here. I'm going to hang on to those. So that's that one and that one, and that one is that one and that one. Okay, so wiping off the glass. I always use glass because then I can clean it up nicely and it makes a nice surface for brayering or using my squeegee or whatever when I get ready to paint. Okay, so let's see, I did that one and that one, and I get that one and that one, but I haven't done that one and that one. So I'm going to use this pink and mix it with this transparent-y orange. And well, first of all, I should probably have done this. Let me back up and do that. That's the blue. That's the pink, or quinacridone red. And that's the transparent orange. So I could use those as well. So what am I doing? Oh yeah, I was doing the pink in this. So this is the combination of the quinacridone red and the transparent orange, and you get this delicious, powerful sunset Margaritaville tequila sunrise red. It's just beautiful. It has this lovely pop to it, this beautiful glow. So now I will add some white to that. Look at that. Isn't that pretty? Oh, I was supposed to put it down there. Well, it's backwards. Sorry. And here's the, I'll add a little black to that. Probably not too much black. And that's got this really pretty color. Okay. Now, so that's combining, and then I can also use the pure colors. So let me put the combinations up here. These are the three that I combined. This one, and then this one, and this one, and this, and this. And so if I mix all of them together, this is what I'm going to get right here. And if I added more white to that, I get a very beautiful gray that goes with these other grays. Look at that. Isn't that fantastic? And then I haven't even mixed those individually with black and white. So let's do that. So here's the blue mixed with a little bit of black just by itself. And what that gets me is this fabulous looking indigo. And then if I mix a little bit of that blue with a little white, then let me add a little more white. That's going to get me a beautiful, almost a sky blue. Look at that. Periwinkle, maybe. Okay, so there's that. Now if I take the quinacridone, let me clean off my spot here. And let me get a little bit more quinacridone. And then just because this black tends to overwhelm things, so it's easy to use too much black. But this gives me kind of this, I don't know, wine color, I'm thinking. I just think that's beautiful mixed with the black. Look at that. Isn't that pretty? And then we can take a little bit of that and we can mix it with some white and more white. We get varying shades of bubble gum, right? So there's that bubble gum-ish pink right there. So there's that. And then one of my favorites is to take the transparent orange and mix it with a little bit of white. I mean, and I just love, love, love this color. This is the prettiest color. Oh man, I could just eat that. It's so delicious. And it also, this other color here, this is beautiful. Wait till you see this. Mixing this with a little bit of black. I always use too much black and it overwhelms it. I have to remember to back off and I always forget. Look at this beautiful brown. Isn't that lovely? Now this is, now I could go varying shades of black or varying shades of white in any of these combinations that I just did to end up with hundreds of colors. And so now what I will do is look at this and sit down and kind of think about how do I want to use these and what do I want to use these on in my next piece. And so the hard work is done of mixing and the panels are prepped. And so now I just get down to business. Okay, now it's time to put some paint on this canvas. But before I did that, in the last segment, I did, I prepped these, and then I did the colors to determine my color value. And then the other thing that I did while I was sitting around outside enjoying the beautiful summer, is I did a whole bunch of sketches, just no tans, just black and white sketches. Of lights and darks, that's all I focused on, so that I could get a feel for what I want to do with this diptych. One thought that I had was I could make one feminine, one masculine, I could make one dark, make one light, I could make them all one, read as one panel. And in the end, what I settled on was this kind of this idea of what I call inside-outside, where one of the panels, the focus of the darkness will be more on the inside, maybe touching an edge part of the panel. And then the other one, the focus would be on the periphery. And I don't know how it's going to turn out and it might get adjusted, but that's what I settled on. And it's important to have a place to start. So I did that. And then the next thing that I've done is I've mixed up four colors of paint. One is a very pale bluish gray. The other is a dark indigo gray, dark. And then I have sort of a brown, which has got some of the color, all the colors in it that I selected. And then I've got one that's sort of a more of the pinkish, popish color. And so I will make adjustments, but I wanted to lay in my darks and lights first so that I can get a better idea of what the layout is going to be. And then adjustments will come after that, mark making, all kinds of things can happen. So it's not like this is how it's going to look, but this is one step in the process. So I shall get to it.
Okay, so we know they're not pretty and they're certainly not finished, but my lights and darks have been laid in and my pops of color, and I will probably adjust the pops of color, and I could adjust the lights and darks when I start doing layering. This will look like a completely different duet in the end, but the important part is I've got my intention laid out in lights and darks. I've selected the colors that I want to use. This is not the end result in terms of the color. This is just some things that I mixed up that happened to be on the palette. I happened to be part of the palette, but I just wanted to get my lights and darks laid in. So now the really cool thing is that in the light areas here, I can do anything within my palette that's light. Within the dark areas here, I can do anything within that area in darks. As long as I maintain the integrity of the darks and the lights, then the design that I've come up with won't move around a lot. Now, it may move around. That happens. It happens all the time because I'm responding to what I'm doing. But this is a good jumping off place. So this is wet. I want to maybe do some mark making. It's a fun time to do mark making. That blue underneath will show through under the white and the gold. And I can just mark it up. And then when I do more layers, I've got texture. And that was also part of the reason for doing those multiple layers that I put underneath. So I'll grab my mark making tool, which is this handy dandy barbecue skewer. I keep these around and go make some marks. So I'm not thinking about it too much. I'm just going to add the things that feel good to me. And this will add a host of energy, I think, to the pieces and connect them. And I might cover some of these up later, but that reddish purple is sort of showing through underneath. It did get down to some of the blue is showing as well, which I think is kind of cool. And that's enough. So I'm about halfway through here where I've gone back to the original lights and darks and just responded to and began layering. And for the most part, I've kept the integrity of the lights and darks, but I've expanded them quite a bit and with different levels of lights and darks. In other words, in the dark area, I've stayed on the darker end of the spectrum, but not everything really dark. There's a lot of variety. I've also gone back in and done additional mark making, and I've used lots of layers between the squeegee and the brayer to get more transparency layers, and the squeegee to get more opaque layers. And then I've also used my R&F oil sticks to mark up the canvas in addition to the marks, and I've used a pale cerulean blue or something like that. Whatever goes with or sort of complementing some of the colors that are already laid down. And working in a Diptych is interesting. I want them to stand alone, but I also want them to go. So that was part of the challenge. But I think they make a very lovely pair. And I am in love with the warm colors and that really hot pinkish orangish gold that I discovered just from layering, and I would not have been able to mix that. All of those were transparent colors, and mixing all transparent colors allowed me
to keep the brightness and didn't dilute it and make it cloudy. If some of those had been opaque mixes, they would have been a little cloudier, and I do have cloudy. Also, too, note that I've put some very dull colors next to some very bright colors, and I've put my darks next to some lights, and I want your eye to continue to move through the canvas so that you don't get bored, and yet also give you a place on each of these to rest your eyes, but to pick up where you left off and continue moving through the canvas.